session, I'll be discussing with you gender identity and social practices in school. So, we'll see what is gender identity and in socialization practices in school, what is the role of teacher, what can be the curriculum. All these aspects will be discussed in this socialization practices in school. If we talk about gender identity, you know, battle of gender identity is very old. As we are aware, gender refers to social classification, men and women into masculine and feminine. Gender is a social construct of sex that owes its creation to a number of social institutions. As there is a battle between the role or identity between gender, most of the time gender and sex, they are used in place of each other. So, we should be clear that sex we talk in biological terms, but gender is defined or assigned on the basis of work assigned by the society. So, it depends in which kind of society or community we are living in and what roles we are supposed to imitate. See, the family and school are the two pillars that influence the child during the process of growth, whereas the other influential factors may be mass media or the our peer group, community stakeholders, or the sources of our entertainment. Other sources, they also influence the process of growth and development of the child, but the two basic pillars are the family and school, because before going to the school, most of the values and beliefs, attitudes and behavior, they are acquired by the child in the family. So, both the parents, mother and father, even our siblings, they influence each other because most of the values are acquired in the society. So, before a child start going to school, gender experiences are picked up in the family, because most of the time it is seen that the role of the parents, they are imitated by the children, and moreover, who is the hero, who is the model of the child in the family, because we try to personify, a child try to identify with one of the parent as he or she wants to become. So, it depends. In the school, teacher is the most influential person who provides various learning experiences to the child. So, the personality of the teacher, or the values, or the ideas, or the behaviors, or attitude of the teacher, or the expectation which a teacher is having from the student, it also depends and it also influences the gender identity and socialization practice of the child. So, the children are exposed to various situations where they learn attitude and behavior. You know, as the child steps out from the house, after learning most of the values in the home, when the child comes out, you know, the child is exposed to various situations, and these situations, and when the child interact in these situations, various values and attitudes are acquired by the child. And school, as the John Dewey has said, that school is a special environment where a certain quality of life and certain type of activities and occupations are provided with the objective of securing the child's development along desirable lives. See, John Dewey, the greatest educationist, has given the very comprehensive definition about the concept of school, that school is an environment where the child is being provided by different activities, and the objective of those activities is that the child come out on the desirable expectation of the teacher of the school. So, again, if I mention the great educationist J.S. Ross, he has said that schools are institutions devised by civilized men for the purpose of aiding in the preparation of the young for well-adjusted and efficient membership of society. See, why we send the child to the school? Because this is the agency where the socialization of a child is possible and which is must for the proper growth and development of a child, because it is expected from individual that one has to learn how to make adjustment in the society and how to become an efficient member of the society, because all the time we cannot think about our vested interest. Sometime we have to sacrifice our selfish or personal interest for the welfare of the society. As from the very beginning, all of us have heard, have learnt in the school, in the family, that sarve bhavantu sukhina, meaning by that we have to think for the welfare of the whole world. We have to teach the world citizenship to the child. So we have to think for the betterment of the everyone on this earth. So we understand that in socialization process, an individual learns to behave according to the expected and established roles based on the sex. When we are talking about the gender identity, we will be discussing, rather we are focusing on this issue, that in shaping the gender identity, what is the role of the school or the teacher or our curriculum in shaping the personality of the child, in making her adjusted to acquire the gender roles which are in the benefit of the individual as well as of the society. School is the second institution after the family that influences the process of socialization. You know, in school, teachers and peers both influence the child. Children internalize gender stereotypes and prejudice, which in turn guide their own preferences and behavior. When through the curriculum, through the illustration, through the examples, or through the parenting style, or through the examples of the teacher, or the behavior of the teacher, when the gender stereotypes and prejudice are acquired by the children, they become their norms, they become their value, and this become their behavior, and they take it as their destiny. In school, the child notices that girls are expected to be soft. Why? And boys are expected to be strong. This leads to role imitation and gender identity. The experiences which children receive in schools contribute to gender differentiation. When these kind of expectations regarding the behavior of the boys and the girls, then this contribute to the gender differentiation. We expect from the teachers a commitment for gender egalitarianism. Teach the students to tell in such situations, removing the gender stereotyping and role imitation. So it all depends on our teachers, their methodology, their illustration, their examples, that they try to establish gender equality, gender egalitarianism in the schools, and they teach their students by quoting such kind of illustration and examples. You know, if we talk about the role of the teachers, when teachers organize activities by gender segregation, which further leads to reinforcing children's gender stereotypes and avoidance of cross-gender playmates. Suppose, you know, when we go as a guest in some of the institution, when we see that at the gate for the welcome, there are the girls only. Why can't be the boys at the gate? They also should learn how to welcome the guest. So why this is expected from the girls that they must know how to welcome the guest? So I'm just giving an example. So these are the teachers, when they organize the activities, why gender segregation? When there were going on, the preparation of the function, why the teacher selected the girls for the welcome only, why not the mixed gender, why should we mixed in that committee also. I'm just giving an example. But even when the children are asked to choose, it has been noticed that the sex hormones also influence their preferences for activities, because I spoke to you earlier that the family is the first pillar. They have learned, they have imitated the role from the family. Girls, daughters, they imitate the role of the mother, and sons imitate the role of the father. So from there, they acquire that role preferences. And even when the teacher in the school, they ask to choose the roles, they also start choosing on the basis of that preferences. So this also leads to gender differentiation. Gender education should be given an important place in the education system. You know, it depends on the school environment whether it is promoting gender similarity or gender differences. I have given you just an example. So it depends on the style or methodology of the teacher, what kind of culture is prevalent in the school, whether the activities the selected by the teachers, they are just promoting the gender similarity or gender differences. So it depends. And I'll suggest you some practices which can be helpful in proper socialization practices. For example, when in assembly we address, well, boys and girls, why not the students? We should address as students, not the well boys and the girls, ladies and gentlemen, because from there, from the very first example, we are talking about the gender differentiation. Do not say beautiful girls, intelligent boys, these kind of adjectives. If we say beautiful girls, so it means we are preparing girls that they have to be prepared to look beautiful only, not to be intelligent. Because I would quote one very simple example, you know, of my childhood. When I was in a growing up stage, I used to hear from my father, he used to say, handsome is that who does handsome. So these kind of examples should be given, which just reduce the gender differentiation. And try to set up a gender equal classroom environment. Help them in setting role models. When we set the role model before the students, should not categorize that the girls are to be like these are the hero for the girls, that you have to copy the role model of the lady only, and the boys have to copy the role of the gents only. Encourage mixed gender friendship, because we have not to segregate that these are the activities, this is the section of the boys and this is the row of the boys or girls. So encourage mixed gender friendship so that there is no segregation, and rotate assigned roles in children. As I was giving an example of the welcome committee, if in one function, if you select the girls for welcome group or welcome committee, in the next we can suggest for the boys, or we can mix up them. Further, we can establish an award to recognize children who promote equity. Do a play about gender equity in school. Develop posters that promote equity. Sometime we can organize a function, poster making competition, or play we can organize, where such kind of play we can select, where we reduce the gender differentiation. And we can observe classroom to detect bias in interaction. Suppose there is free time, there is recess. If we notice that the girls are interacting with girls and boys are interacting with boys, then it is wrong. We have to teach them that there is no gender differentiation. We have to learn from each other. So this kind of gender egalitarian attitude should be established. This all depends on the attitude and methodology of the teacher. You know, there are various gender based constraints to the girls' education, which should be eradicated by empowering girls. How do? Through inculcating in them the skill for self-confidence. assertiveness and speaking out and decision making. Very important, the last one which I have called decision making. It has been noticed that the girls and the women, ladies, they hesitate in decision making. So we have to encourage the girls from the very beginning, when it is your own life, when you have to decide for yourself why to ask for the decision from another gender, another sex. So you have to decide. So this kind of decision making and assertiveness to say your concept or whatever you are feeling, you must speak out, and this kind of self confidence should be developed in the children, in the girls. It is needed that boys should be empowered with skills to dealing from gender oppressive attitudes and practices such as bullying. You know, I'm not talking about empowering the girls only. We have to empower our sons also. We have to empower the boys also, because if we talk about girls only, then again I'll be talking about gender differentiation. So I'm talking about gender equity. I'm talking about gender equality. That's why we are focusing on gender identity and what can be the role of the teacher and what kind of school environment should be there in acquiring the gender identity, so that socialization practices is possible. They must be made aware to accept gender equality positively. As I have spoken to you, that family is the first pillar before they come to the school. It is the duty of the parents that they teach right things, appropriate behavior to their sons as well as to their daughters. And guidance and counseling desk should be established in schools and colleges in order to provide services for the social and psychological development of girls and boys. These days, there is a special post of counselors in the schools, because the teachers who are teaching, they are fully loaded with their workload, so they don't have spare time to guide them psychologically. So the counselor in the school, counselor in the institution, can guide the children, boys as well as girls, about their psychological and social dealings whenever they require the help of the counselor. So such kind of guidance and counseling desk should be established in schools. It will be really helpful for gender identity, and teachers should be trained in the skills for making teaching and learning processes responsive to the specific needs of both the genders. See, we want to train our students, our children, but before that we have to be ensure that our teachers are fully trained. So if not, our teachers should be given training in the skills so that they can teach their students that how to be responsive to the specific needs of both the genders. Because along with the theoretical knowledge, along with passing out the examination, along with acquiring or snatching the degrees, we have to work that our students, our children should turn out in a responsive citizen, so that they can think for the welfare of the whole world. Because these days we know the whole of the world is going through a crisis. So it is the need of the time that we have to teach our children at home, in schools also, that how to think for the welfare of the world. So teachers have to be trained so that they can develop, they can teach the children to be responsive to the needs of both the gender. It depends on the teachers also how they interpret the curriculum. Now after the school and the teachers, I am talking about the curriculum. It depends on the teacher how they interpret the curriculum, how they interact with the learners, and how they assign the duties. Because what kind of curriculum is being followed in the school and how the teachers, which kind of strategies and methods or the approaches are being used by the teacher, it also depends. And what are the content of the curriculum, because we have to see what is the need of the time. So all these factors contribute in gender identity, because I spoke to you that the two pillars, that is family and teacher, are the main pillar. But along with this, which kind of curriculum, what kind of books a child is reading, and what is the source of entertainment of the child, and who is the peer group of the child, and who is the idol of the child, all these factors, they influence in acquiring the gender identity. So all these factors contribute in gender identity, because our whole objective is to socialize the child, that how to socialize the child from different approaches. That is our main objective, because we want that a child must learn how to adjust in the society, and not always thinking of the personal interest. Rather, a student must learn how to sacrifice the personal interest for the wake of the welfare of the society, welfare of the world. So all these factors contribute in gender identity. Now, if I talk about examinations, you know, examinations tend to dominate assessment, but other methods should be used, such as continuous assessment. You know, if all the time the child is preparing just to pass out the examination, just to snatch the degree, then it will be bad, because in that case, examination will be dominating the assessment. Rather, we are talking about CCA, that is continuous development of the child should be assessed. It may be possible that a particular student is not good maybe in physics, maybe in language, maybe history, but is good in sports, maybe good in music, in painting, or in other activities, or in dramatic activities. So those kind of different activities performed by a student in the school, they also must be recognized, because we are talking about the all-round development of the child, holistic growth of the child. So in that case, if the examination tend to dominate the assessment, it will be bad, because that's why we are talking about the grading system, that the child should not be psychologically upset. And if we are talking about the gender equality, girls should be motivated more and more, so that they come out from the four walls of the house, and they must take part equally in all the activities. So it depends on the functioning of the school and approaches of the teacher. And just now, few second back, I have spoken to you that teacher must be trained for this skill development of the students, because how can we expect all kind of attitude and behaviors from the students if the teacher is not trained. So our first duty is to, because as a teacher educator, I always talk about it, that our teacher should be given training from time to time, so that they are in a position to for updating their knowledge. As the here I would like to quote Shri Rabindranath Tagore, who has just given his statement that a teacher can teach the students only when he or she is in a learning mode, because teacher is always a learner. He is not, or she is not a master. He or she must be thinking that I have to learn more and more, so that I can update my knowledge and I can teach my students. Even the teachers should be trained on gender quality teaching through practical approach. They must be given the training how they can promote the gender quality. So this kind of practical approach, practical training should be given to the teachers. We can organize some conference, some seminars, some workshop in the institution, and a gender equitable curricula should be adopted in schools. And the ideas and practices marked by gender equality depends on the curricula and methods of teaching. If we want to achieve gender equitable education where there is no conflict between men and women regarding gender identity, then teachers' awareness is must. It must be ensured that curriculum development involves consultation at all levels. Gender awareness and sensitization programs should be started by teachers. Moreover, while they teach or interact with students, gender equality should be reflected from their attitude and illustration. Capacity building centers should be established in all educational institutions where all teachers and teacher educators can be trained in order to help individuals in gender identity. So, lastly, this is the duty of the teachers to help students in understanding the portrayal of gender images given in textbooks. Children need help in responding to gender textbooks. Teachers should create such an environment where children are motivated to be a part of mixed gender groups. It will help children to have better understanding of gender differences and similarities. Gender egalitarian attitude and behavior should be promoted. Policy makers and teachers can join their hands in it. Lastly, teachers can help the individuals in conservation and promotion of culture. They must help the children in realizing the gender identity and performing roles appropriate for oneself and as well as for society. So, I hope with this, the audience and the viewers must be aware and they will be ready to accept it and to realize it, that family and teacher, both agency have their its own role in socializing the child and acquiring the gender identity. Thank you.